guys, welcome to this session on Apache Spark's architecture. So let us see the agenda for today. In this session, we will start off by having a look at a real-time industry use case where Spark was used to solve the problems faced by Yahoo. Then we'll understand what is Spark and shed some light on some of its features. After that, we'll see different components of Spark, and then we'll cover Spark architecture in detail. And at last, we'll learn how to create a Spark application. So let us understand the problems that Yahoo was facing before Spark. So Yahoo properties are highly personalized to maximize relevance. That is, the algorithms which were used to provide personalization, that is, targeted advertisement and personalized content, were highly sophisticated. And the relevance model had to be updated frequently as the stories, newsfeed and ads kept changing with time. And Yahoo also had over 150 petabytes of data, which was stored on a 35,000 node Hadoop cluster, which had to be accessed efficiently in order to avoid latency caused by the data movement, and also to gain insights from data in a cost-effective manner. So Yahoo looked to Spark to improve performance of its iterative model training. So the machine learning algorithm that was used for news personalization required around 15,000 lines of C++ code. While on the other hand, the machine learning algorithm implemented with Spark had just 120 lines of Scala programming code, and the algorithm was ready for production use in just 30 minutes of training on a dataset with 100 million records. Now, isn't that just amazing? So Yahoo uses Apache Spark for personalizing its news web pages and targeted advertising. Yahoo also uses machine learning algorithm that runs on Apache Spark to find out what kind of news users are interested to read, and also for categorizing the news stories to find out what kind of users would be interested in reading each category of news. And with the help of Spark, Yahoo was also able to reduce latency of model training via in-memory processing. So now you might have understood how Yahoo benefited from Spark. Now let us understand about Spark briefly. So it is a cluster computing framework for real-time processing. It was actually Hadoop sub-project introduced in the UC Berkeley R&D lab in the year 2009, and it became open source in 2010. And in 2013, it was donated to Apache Software Foundation. So it provides an interface for programming all the clusters with implicit data parallelism and fault tolerance. Now, let us see some of the interesting features of Spark. So, Spark provides real-time computation and low latency because of in-memory computation. And Spark is 100 times faster for large-scale data processing. And Spark is also polyglot. So, you can write Spark applications in multiple languages such as Java, Scala, Python, R, and SQL. Spark also has powerful caching. So it has simple programming layer which provides powerful caching and disk persistence capabilities. And Spark also provides multiple deployment modes. So it can be deployed through Mesos, Hadoop via Yarn, or Spark's own cluster manager. Now Spark's impact was such that from small startups to Fortune 500s, almost every single company started adopting Apache Spark to build, scale, and innovate their big data applications. Industries like media, healthcare, finance, e-commerce, and travel, almost all are using Spark intensively. Now, let us go ahead and understand the concept of RDDs in Spark. So, when it comes to processing the data over multiple jobs, we need to reuse and share the data, which can be achieved through in-memory data sharing, which is actually faster than network and disk sharing. So, this is where RDDs come in to help us with in-memory data sharing. So RDD stands for Resilient Distributed Dataset, and it is the fundamental data structure of Apache Spark. So by resilient, I mean fault tolerant, as it can recompute missing or damaged partitions in case of a node failure with the help of RDD lineage graph. And it is distributed since data resides on multiple nodes. And finally, dataset represents records of the data you work with. The user can load the dataset externally, which can be either a JSON file, CSV file, text file, or a database. So RDDs are an immutable collection of objects and any attempt to change an RDD results in a whole new RDD. So let us understand this now. Consider an RDD over which you perform transformations like map, filter, and so on. So this will create a whole new RDD but will not calculate anything. In order to calculate a result, you'll have to perform actions on RDD like count, save as text file, and so on, which will display the result accordingly. Now let us understand the various components of Spark ecosystem. So let me start with Spark core component, which is the most vital component of Spark ecosystem. It is responsible for basic IO functions, scheduling, monitoring, and so on. So you can see that the entire Spark ecosystem is built on top of it. Then we have different deployment modes. So Spark can be deployed through Hadoop IAM, Mesos, or Spark's own cluster manager. Then we have different libraries. So the Spark ecosystem library is composed of Spark SQL, MLlib, GraphX, and streaming. So Spark SQL helps us in performing queries on data and also to store data using SQL-like queries. Then we have MLlib. So the Spark machine learning library eases the deployment and development of scalable machine learning pipelines like summary statistics, correlation, feature extraction, and many others. And graphics component of Spark helps the data scientists to work with graphs and non-graph sources to achieve flexibility and resilience in graph construction and transformation. Then we finally have the Spark streaming component, which allows us to perform batch processing and streaming of data in the application. Coming to the programming languages, Spark can be implemented in Scala, R, Python, and Java. However, Scala is the widely used language for Spark. And finally, we can store data over HDFS, local file system, and cloud. It also supports SQL and NoSQL databases. So now you might have got a brief idea about Spark's components. Now let us dive into Spark architecture. So Apache Spark has a well-defined layered architecture where all the Spark components and layers are loosely coupled. Spark uses a master worker architecture, and in your master node, you have the driver program which drives your application. Now you might be thinking, what is a driver program? So basically, the code which you're writing behaves as a driver program. Or if you're using the interactive shell, the shell acts as a driver program. The driver program runs the main function of the application, and it is the place where the Spark context is created. So assume that the Spark context is a gateway to all the Spark functionalities. Now, the Spark driver contains various components like DAG scheduler, task scheduler, backend scheduler, and block manager, which are responsible for the translation of Spark user code into actual Spark jobs executed on the cluster. So the Spark driver and Spark context take care of the job execution within the cluster. Now, Spark context works with the cluster manager to manage various jobs. And the cluster manager is responsible for acquiring resources on the Spark cluster and allocating them to a Spark job. Now, this job is split into multiple tasks which are distributed over the worker node. So anytime an RDD is created in Spark context, it can be distributed across various nodes and can be cached there. And finally, we have the worker nodes, which are actually the slave nodes whose job is to basically execute the task and return back the result to the Spark context. So inside the worker nodes, we have executors. So an executor is a distributed agent responsible for the execution of tasks. And every Spark application has its own executor process. So executors usually run for the entire lifetime of a Spark application. To sum it up, Spark context takes the job, breaks the job in tasks, and distributes them to the worker nodes. These tasks then work on the partitioned RDD, perform operations, collect the results, and return to the main Spark context. And if you increase the number of workers, then you can divide jobs into more partitions and execute them parallelly over multiple systems. So it'll be a lot faster. And with the increase in the number of workers, memory size will also increase and you can cache the jobs to execute it faster. So now let us understand Spark's runtime architecture. When a client submits a Spark user application code, the driver implicitly converts the code containing transformations and actions into a logical directed acyclic graph or DAG. At this stage, the driver program also performs certain optimizations like pipelining transformations, and then it converts the logical DAG into physical execution plan with a set of stages. After creating the physical execution plan, it creates small physical execution units referred to as tasks under each stage. Then tasks are bundled to be sent to the Spark cluster. Now the driver program talks to the cluster manager and negotiates for resources. The cluster manager then launches executors on the worker nodes on behalf of the driver. At this point, the driver sends tasks to the cluster manager based on data placement. And before executors begin execution, they register themselves with the driver program so that the driver has holistic view of all the executors. And once this is done, executors start executing the various tasks assigned by the driver program. And at any point of time when the Spark application is running, the driver program will monitor the set of executors that run. And finally, when the driver program's main method exits, or when it calls the stop method of the Spark context, it'll terminate all the executors and release the resources from the cluster manager. So this is Spark's runtime architecture. Now let us see the various ways by which Spark can be deployed. The system currently supports these cluster managers. So we have Spark standalone cluster, which is a simple cluster manager included with Spark that makes it easy to set up a cluster. Then we have Apache Mesos, which is a general cluster manager that can also run Hadoop, Mapreduce and service applications. After that, we have Hadoop via YARN. And finally, we can also deploy it via Kubernetes, which is an open source system for automating deployment, scaling and management of containerized applications. So this was all about the Spark architecture. Now let us see a small demo on how to create a Spark application. So I have created a folder with the name Welcome World, which comprises of the source code to build the Spark application. So let me just go inside this folder. So I'll type cd welcome world. Now let me show you guys what are the components inside this folder. So there are two components. One is the build.sbt file, and then we have the src folder. So this build.sbt file basically consists of all the dependencies to build the Spark application jar file. So let me just show you guys all of the dependencies. So I'll type vi and then give the name of the file, which would be build.sbt. Right, so these are the dependencies. First we have the name of the application, then we have the version of the application, and then we have the Scala version over here. Now let me also show you guys the source code which would be present in this src folder. So I will type cd and then give the name of the folder src. And this src folder comprises another folder, which is main. Let me go inside this cd main. And again, this main folder comprises of another folder, which is Scala. So let me also go inside this. So I'll type cd Scala. So let me show you guys what is there inside the Scala folder. I'll type ls again. Right. So this welcome.scala file, which is present inside the Scala folder, comprises of the source code. So let me show you the source code. I'll type vi and then give the name of this class, which would be welcome.scala. Right, so this is the source code. So we have this class with the name welcome, and then inside the name function, we have given the code. So we'll be just printing welcome world. This is a session on Spark. So let me head back to the welcome world folder and build the jar file. Right, so we are back to the welcome world folder. So here we have got these two, build.sbt and src. So now to build the jar file, I would have to use this command, sbt package, and then this will build a jar file. Right, so we see that the jar file has been successfully built, and this is the path for the jar file, home training welcome world. And over here we have the jar file over here. So this is the name of the jar file, welcome world, and this is the version of it. So now I'll type ls, and over here we see that initially we just had the src folder and the build.sbt file. After building the jar file, we also have these two folders over here, which is project and target. And this jar file is present in this target folder. So let me head inside this target folder. I'll type cd target. And this target folder comprises of these two folders again. So let me also go inside this Scala 2.11 folder. So I'll type cd Scala 2.11. And let me see what is there inside this. Right. So we have a jar file over here. Welcome world. This is the version and this is a jar file. Right. So now that we have a jar file ready, I can go ahead and submit the job to create the application. So let me write the command for that. So the command would be spark submit. I'll type hyphen hyphen and then I'll type class. After that, I'll give space and then give the name of the file. So the name of the file would be welcome. So earlier we had seen the file welcome.scala. So over here we are giving the name of the same class, which is welcome. Right. And after that, I'll give a space again, type hyphen hyphen, and then I will type master over here. And then I'll specify the deployment mode. So the deployment mode would be Hadoop yarn. So I'll just type yarn over here. And then I'll give the path of the jar file. Right. So we see that we have successfully created the Spark application. So initially we had seen the source code for this. Welcome world. This is a session on Spark. So after submitting the job, we have finally created this application, right? So guys, this is how we can create a Spark application. And this brings us to the end of the session. Thank you for attending.